Racing north, we set our compass on Idaho. With a population of little more than 1.5 million and the 14th largest state, we knew there was opportunity to explore unfettered by crowds and congestion. We weren't disappointed. Offshoots of the Rockies, the mountains run throughout the state, giving birth to numerous rivers, streams, and lakes. Well-known names like the Snake, Salmon, Clark Fork, Lake Ponderay, Lake Coeur d'Alene, and Alturas pump life into the Sawtooth, the Bitterroots, the Kootenays, and the Frank Church Wilderness, and were a big draw for us. Also known as the Gem State, the Potato State, and for its logging and silver mines, we sought out the rich history of this somewhat isolated region, bounded by 6 other larger states and by Canada. The Sawtooth Mountains, origin of the Salmon and Snake Rivers, were our first stop, camped on Lake Alturas near famous Redfish Lake. To the west is the Snake River, running through Hell's Canyon, deeper than the Grand Canyon. Not too far north is Coeur d'Alene, a beautiful and large lake, hiding the silver mine toxins settled into the bottom. We found a campsite to ourselves east of Coeur d'Alene on the way to the Hiawatha Trail, a bike ride I had to do. Getting there, one passes Wallace and Kellogg, built on silver mining, where even the brothel is just another museum. The Hiawatha Bike Trail starts in Montana and runs west into Idaho, following the roadbed of the former Milwaukee Railroad. The bike ride is a hoot, running through tunnels up to 1.6 miles long, unlit, and across trestles 1,000 feet long. Along the 16-mile trail, you drop 1,000 feet as you learn about the all-electric trains that ran from Chicago to Tacoma. Lucky for me, there was a bus to take me back to the top of the mountain. North of Coeur d'Alene is Lake Ponderay, more than 1,000 feet deep and over 30 miles long. Sand Point is the core community, and we arrived at the Farmers and Craft Market in time for homegrown entertainment.
Last night I dreamed you were back again, larger than life again, holding me tight again.
We camped by the water at our friend's cabin, just in time for July 4th fireworks. Not far north of Sand Point is Bonner's Ferry, just south of the border with British Columbia. Ellen's brother and sister-in-law have a summer cabin there and treat us to ATVing on the infamous Ruby Ridge. The northern part of Idaho is so narrow that Montana is just a few miles east, and the Kootenai River is a must-see made famous in the movie The Revenant. When in Bonner's Ferry, entertainment is spelled rodeo.
That was awesome. You see, by the dawn's
Oh! grab a horse and get on and go to work. It takes a lot of time to find that right horse. We'll touch on that after this run. Quick little loop. Long lenses out. Watch the hands. Here's one right now. Come on.
Good luck in
here. Ride.
After the rodeo wound down, street dancing wound up. It was time to say goodbye and head back into Montana to explore the Yak River before heading north into British Columbia following Lake Kootenay. This enormous lake provides hydroelectric power and boating, and along the shore, we discovered where Harry Potter got his magic broom.
So tell me what you're doing with that broom.
So, I'm stitching it flat.
On the way to Nelson, nestled in the Rockies, a free ferry took us across the lake. Old ferries never die, they just become B&Bs. We found Nelson, in British Columbia, to be an eclectic Rocky Mountain town. Back on our side of the border, western Montana is lush with groves of giant cedars, bands of wild sheep, and free-flowing rivers and streams. It was time to strike out west across Idaho, cut through eastern Washington, and intercept the mighty Columbia. Ship traffic still exists between the Pacific and Lewiston, Idaho, made possible by a series of locks that bypass the areas of rapids and hydroelectric plants. The Columbia River Gorge was formed when the Columbia River cut through many layers of basalt that had welled up and flowed out from earlier ages of volcanism. One result is that numerous rivers tumble down the canyon walls, while others issue forth from in-between layers of basalt. The Cascades Mountain Range, which is bisected by the Columbia, sponges up all that rain and returns it to the river in an almost endless succession of waterfalls, each prettier than the preceding. The river used to have a number of rapids and falls, restricting boat travel. But a series of dams, locks, and hydroelectric plants radically altered the natural face of the Columbia. One species of fish continuing to hang on is the lamprey eel, and giant sturgeon, reaching over 100 years of age, can still be found. Having been through the Panama Canal aboard my own boat, I was surprised to learn that at the Bonneville Locks, the rise was more than 80 feet, not the 42 I experienced at Miraflores. Mount Hood looks out over Portland, and in the summer, they're still skiing at the top. Leaving the Portland area, we headed south to the Deschutes River in Bend. From our camp in Sisters, we set out to explore the Cascades, tumbling streams and falls, and recent volcanic activity. This area is a hiker's heaven, and Bella and I took full advantage. We hiked the Sisters area, the Mackenzie Summit area, and the Paulina Volcanic Monument. But Bella and I enjoyed the MacArthur Rim Trail best of all. Finally, it was time to hit the coast, so we headed west to Florence, an
the National Sand Dunes Recreation Area to set up camp and explore north and south. Newport was a particularly soulful sea town where fresh seafood is spoken everywhere. Heading south, we explored Coos Bay and Cape Blanco before crossing into California, and then we were homeward bound.